Hello and welcome to yet another podcast series of Brickwork Ratings. Today we have a very special guest with us, Dr. Atish Chattopadhyay. He is an educator and also an entrepreneur and a very keen believer in the globalization of Indian business school. And he is currently the director of Jagdeep Seth School of Management and also the vice chancellor of Vijay Bhumi University. A very warm welcome to you, sir, and thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks, Payal. Great pleasure being here.
Thank you so much, sir. So, in order to set the conversation going, I would just like to ask you a very basic question. I think it is very much, relevant in seeing the present situation. Like, the pandemic has actually disrupted the entire economy. So I'm very sure that the education sector is also going through a lot of disruption at the moment. So what do you think are the present challenges, or you can say the crisis that the education sector is facing right now?
First of all, thanks for asking this question. To me, I look at this more like an opportunity than a crisis. Okay. Far too long, education has remained, a very conventional in its approach. And the COVID actually has created an opportunity to innovate. Okay. I would say forced to innovate. Some of the institutions, of course, were innovating. Some of the universities were innovative. But one of the things that has made really possible is to look at how education is going to unfold going forward. And I look at it from three basic angles. Number one is the students or the learners. Number two, the faculty. And number three, the curriculum. All three will undergo a change, but more importantly, educational institutions, as we have known in the past, will definitely not remain the same going forward. That's the fundamental change that is going to happen. And to me, that is good for the education.
Rightly said, sir. So just how you have said, like COVID has completely changed the scenario. Like earlier, like we had seen, the chalk talk method of teaching, where the teacher used to come to the classroom and they used to teach face to face. Whereas now we are completely shifting toward a technology driven mode of learning. So we can very rightly say that this disruption is something that we can see at a very large scale now. And do you think that this puts more pressure on the policymakers to figure out methods to, engagement and also to amend the policy, the education policy which we have right now?
See, from the policymakers' perspective, they have to understand how education is going to change. And let me give you two, three important factors which are going to happen. Number one is technological disruption that we are talking about. And COVID-induced disruption is the second important factor. Okay. Now, what it implies, okay, online, even if it does not create an immediate, in-person, there is a physical distance, but yet it remains engaging, as you have experienced. So online, the way it has been seen earlier, mostly it was recorded lectures. But if it is like a conversation that we are having right now, that the learner and the faculty or the teacher both are on a synchronous mode, I think the learning outcome or the engagement goes up significantly. Okay. That's one thing that technology has done. And probably COVID has forced. But more importantly, your generation is going to live for 100 years, COVID or no COVID. And hence, you will not be in a single profession the way it was. So earlier, it was 25 years of learning, maybe 35 years of earning, and another, say, 15 years of retirement. That's if you take it as 75 years of lifespan, okay? Which is, which we take as, which we used to look at it normally. So 60 years was the retirement age. Now, if you have to live for 100 years, then you have to work at least for 80 years. Okay. Now, somebody who is graduating at 24, 25 will have to work for 55 years, which means there will be a continuous requirement to learn. And learning to learn will become more important. Continuous reskilling. What does that mean? It means that it will be very different from way education is to happen, that you start, you finish your graduation or post-graduation or whatever, and then you just work. It will be now work, earn, learn, work, earn, learn, and this cycle will go on. Okay. And given the fact that there is so many providers of good education, and that is good for the world. I'm talking not just India or an institution, but it's good for the world. A learner will be free to choose what they would like to learn from anywhere in the world. Okay. Now, for example, you are doing MBA. You might take, 10 credits from Darden. Okay, because you want to do MarTech. You might take, some special credits from some other school. Example, you want to do entrepreneurship course from Babson. Okay. And maybe, IT courses or technology courses from Carnegie Mellon. And technology has enabled that. You can sit here and enroll for the courses which are available. So educational institutions essentially are going to become platforms which actually, certifies the credits earned by a learner, which means a learner should be able to accumulate credits from across institutions and whenever they want to. It may not be that only a 2-year you have to complete a program. It can be like, do some credit today, get a certification. Again, you work. After 2 years, you decide to do another certification, accumulate some credits. And when you accumulate the required credits, you get a degree which accepts all the credit. Which means there are two things. Education is going to be unbundled. And educational institutions, instead of being the only one to provide all the educational, input and hence the credits and the outcome, it will be a set of schools coming together, which means institutions will become distributed institutions or universities, where a learner will be able to accumulate credits from across institutions, certified by the home institution, and earn their degree. So, two major outcomes of technological disruption owing to COVID, which has only enhanced it, the adoption of technology. Number two, 100-year life. So, continuously you have to keep on learning. Two outcomes, institutions become more like distributed institutions, and we will see an unbundling of education the way we know it.
Do you think the learning outcome that basically is provided on online classes is actually the same that we used to have in the traditional or, you know, classroom learning? Do you think it is at par with it?
See, the knowledge outcome will reasonably remain the same. Okay. But understand one thing, and you are a recent graduate, you must, you will appreciate that the fact that the you don't look at a faculty only from the perspective of knowledge. You know, faculty also inspires. Faculty is also role model. And faculty has, you know, a lot of, you know, influence on the emotion of the learners. Okay. The online is devoid of the emotions. Knowledge will be there, but when there are emotions involved, where the learner feels connected, okay, it's a very different feel altogether. I think the online education's biggest challenge is, and I take that example, you can watch the cricket match on the television live. Same Sachin Tendulkar playing. Okay. And you remember when Adam Gilchrist came to IFM, you were not there. Or you were there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We were there.
Okay. You were there. Okay. So now think of it that I was narrating in that my talk when Gilchrist was sitting on stage and I was there. My experience of being in Eden Gardens when Harbhajan did the hat-trick and India won. Correct?
Yeah.
Now, the same thing you can watch in the television. But when you are in Eden Gardens, it's a feeling. Okay, it's a very different feeling altogether. A classroom is like watching a performance sitting at Eden Gardens and feeling connected, okay, which can never happen on online. You will know that the, you know, match is happening. You can see the entire, you know, how Harbhajan is bowling or Tendulkar is batting. But on the television, okay, when you are at home, you are not part of that group, which is actually, you know, boosting for India and is celebrating as and when every wicket falls. Okay. That can never happen on an online mode where, you know, you are just one of the, you know, that emotional connect can never happen. Otherwise, everything remains the same. But I think there is more to just the knowledge part. There is more to just watching the game. So as long as spectators throng to Eden Garden, okay, you will find learners thronging to campuses.
Correct, sir. So the emotional connection.
But both will exist. Television also exists. And Eden Gardens also exists. Okay. You have not dismantled the stadium.
Yes, sir.
The classrooms will remain. Don't worry.
Yes, sir. So, sir, if I talk about the higher education sector, so it is one of the very crucial, factor or the determinant, like for the country's economy. So with this pandemic, how do you think that it has affected the employment rate in the present situation?
See, employment will never remain the same the way it was earlier. Okay. Because the office, the way we knew it, will change. Okay. Because companies will suddenly find that all those work that can be done from home did not be done from office. Okay. And that has got both plus and minus. Workplace is not just a place for work. It is also a place for socialization. And mind that human beings are by nature social. Correct. So this whole concept of, I think that it will be again a product life cycle type, where suddenly there will be a, you know, what I call the you know, flavor of the day. You go to a restaurant, you will get some flavor of the day, which is the special dish of the day. See, this work from home will go through its own cycle. And suddenly people will realize that, you know, you are working, but you are not in a social setup. So I think for the foreseeable near future, there will be, you know, a boom to work from home, learn from home, all that. But then at some point in time, there will be a point where there has to be a balance, where again you will see that people would like to do the same work while being at a place, whether it will be called an office or, you know, like you are creating new terms, whether you will be calling it a socio office or some kind of a terminology where you socialize and yet work. That kind of a thing will work. It cannot be that people working from home for such a long time, and you know, office is also like a club. People, you know, even though people talk about the weekends, but going to office is also like going to a club. Everybody knows, because there is a gossip, there is a, you know, collegiality, or people come together and be together. So I don't think that office will be eliminated completely, even though it will assume a different character. As far as education is concerned, I think there was no reason for having such a prolonged lockdown. Particularly, you know, for not getting the education up and running. Because finally, education is what determines the, you know, the future of the society and the country. Just like we had frontline workers, frontline workers like health workers and others vaccinated fast, I think the college students and the teachers should have been vaccinated much earlier, and we should have been back in action. Okay, I think we have lost quite a bit of time. Faster we come back, better it is. It will have an impact on the emotions of the young generation, which I am more concerned about than just being locked down. By the way, just look at it. All India Institute of Medical Science, where you have, you know, all the action happening, there the classes are physical and the classes are happening. Okay. Yes. Now, if you can have classes in a medical college where there are all the COVID patients, you know, COVID patients, why can't you have college, you know, classes elsewhere? It was, to my mind, I tend to disagree with this decision of closing the colleges. Schools, I understand, but closing the colleges for such a long time, I don't think that was a good decision.
So this brings me to one more question. Like recently I came across one of your articles, like, is it advisable to, you know, take a break during this pandemic time? So in that you have also mentioned like the cost of the gap year, which the student will have to face. So would you like to, you know, share some more insight about that? And because there are a lot of students today who are actually thinking of taking a gap, because, you know, maybe they'll not get to see the university or the colleges. They will not be able to interact with the faculty on a day-to-day basis, like how they used to do in the campus. So would you advise students to take a gap? Like,
makes no sense to me. Okay, reason, which I've written very categorically. Reason is this, that I think by August, you know, Karnataka government has made a target of 7th July. To vaccinate our college students. You know, now that there is, you know, certain degree of availability of vaccines, Okay. The first thing that should be done is to get the college teachers and the students vaccinated and get the classes on. So I think by August, all schools and colleges should start opening, colleges especially. Schools, I know 18 below, okay, the vaccine is still not available. But colleges should be up and functional. I think the government must understand that if you vaccinate only the elderly and you allow the kids to do all activities excepting going to schools and colleges, okay, I think that is not good. There will be no, whatever gap year was there has happened. Okay, nobody took gap last year. So this year there is no point in taking gap. I would never consider a gap year until and unless you are working somewhere or traveling. Neither you want to work nor you can travel.
I would just like to ask you, like, would you like to highlight certain strategies or something which can actually help the institutes as well, the government, to, you know, manage a crisis like this? Because you never know, the future is not certain, so anything can happen. So do you think like there are certain guidelines that which needs to be incorporated from now itself?
See, if you look at it and you have been in the institution, when this lockdown, even before the lockdown was happening, the lockdown was imminent and we were preparing. When this kind of a pandemic happens, it is not going to go away. So you have to be ready to be as normal as possible. Okay? And how can we make it happen? Finally, we are saying that this is a wave, first wave, second wave, third wave. So anybody who has, you know, who does swimming in the sea knows how to negotiate the waves. Correct. You have to ride the wave, essentially. What does that mean? When there, again, there will be a third wave, there will be a fourth wave, waves will keep on coming. Okay. Now the question is, whenever, how do you prepare? When you are operating, prepare what you are going to do for a lockdown. When you are, you know, going to be locked in. When you are in the lockdown, prepare what all you need to do when it opens up. So just look at the calendar like this. Like normally we say 5 days of work and 2 days of off. Here you say 8 weeks of work and 4 weeks of off. Okay. And you manage it accordingly. That is one. Then there is no challenge. And as a matter of fact, you know that we will be one of the few institutions, I don't know of any other institution who actually conducted classes on campus. Okay. Now, and there were everybody who were in campus were safe. And still there are in the hostel, they are all safe. Why they are safe? Because every week we were doing RT-PCR testing. There was a protocol which was being maintained. Correct. If a proper protocol for COVID is maintained, everybody is aware that, you know, this is the protocol you need to maintain. You test regularly, then we will be safe. Just like doctors are safe, just like police officers are safe, students will also be safe. Those who are in the offices will be also be safe. As a matter of fact, those who are in action, they are the ones who are least impacted. I can tell you from my personal example, my both parents got impacted. My brother, his wife, his kids, all of them got impacted. Okay, who were staying at home? I was going to office every day. Because that time you were doubly cautious.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So my suggestion is, COVID or virus is never going to go away. We need to learn how to navigate the waves. So when there is a, you know, unlock, prepare for a lockdown. When there's a lockdown, prepare for an unlock. Follow the COVID protocol, take vaccination, and do testing frequently. I have done at least 12 RT-PCR tests for myself. follow the protocol. Personal hygiene is important. I think the training for personal hygiene is critical.
Correct.
Imagine, and the assumption should be that everybody whom you meet is an infected individual.
True.
Then you are safe.
100%. This brings to an end, sir, my questions, and thank you so much for sharing your valuable insights about all the different questions that I asked, and giving your valuable insight about the sector, like how it is facing the challenge, and also the path to recovery, we can say, like how we have to be impromptu, like you have to be ready for the crisis situation, because it is something that can happen anytime, any year. So thank you so much for sharing your valuable insights and sharing your time with us, sir.
Thanks, Payal. Always a pleasure to interact with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.